The last of our three rock types is metamorphic rocks, and these rocks form in a different manner from both the igneous and the sedimentary rocks. Metamorphic rocks form when pre-existing rocks undergo metamorphism, which is essentially high temperatures and pressures. Notably, metamorphic rocks form from other rocks, not from magma, like igneous rocks, and not from sediment, like sedimentary rocks. The pre-existing rock is called the protolith, which literally means the before rock. So all metamorphic rocks have protoliths, and the prefix proto literally means before, and lith means rock. So it's the before rock, or the parent rock, to a metamorphic rock. Protoliths can be igneous rocks, sedimentary rocks, or even other metamorphic rocks. But when these rocks undergo temperatures and pressures much greater than the conditions under which they originally formed, they change. And they can change their texture or their mineral composition, but importantly, they're not melting, because that would create magma. So the rocks, these protoliths, are just undergoing changes which change them from one type of rock into a metamorphic rock. I'm going to give several examples of a protolith and its metamorphic rock pair. So limestone, which is a sedimentary rock made out of shells, when it is exposed to high temperatures, it basically turns into marble, which is a crystalline metamorphic rock. Similarly, sandstone is a detrital sedimentary rock made out of pieces of sand that can turn into the crystalline metamorphic rock quartzite when it's exposed to very high temperatures. It's not only sedimentary rocks that can be protoliths, however. The igneous rock peridotite that makes up the mantle, when it's exposed to high temperature waters, can turn into serpentinite, which is the California state rock. Shale is another detrital sedimentary rock made out of muds that can turn into the crystalline rock, metamorphic rock, slate, when it's exposed to very high pressures. Metamorphic rocks can be protoliths too, as if that slate is exposed to even higher temperatures and pressures, it can turn into a rock called schist, which may be exposed to even high temperatures and pressures, and turn into another metamorphic rock called gneiss. So here we've given examples of several different metamorphic rocks, and we've noted the specific protolith from which they came. And we've also noted that protoliths can be igneous rocks, sedimentary rocks, or even other metamorphic rocks. Well, what causes metamorphism? Just a few minutes ago, we said that high temperatures and pressures cause metamorphism. This is essentially true, but we're going to list three agents of metamorphism, three causes of metamorphism. The first and most important is definitely heat. And that heat can come from deep burial, because as you go deeper in the earth, it's hotter. That can cause metamorphism. Or it can be the heat associated with being somewhere nearby a magma chamber. Another common agent of metamorphism is pressure. And there's two types of pressure that might result in metamorphism. The first one's called confining pressure, and it's simply when a rock gets buried deep in the earth. And there's actually pressure from all angles on that rock. On the other hand, we're going to learn next week that there's times and places on Earth where there's a lot of directed pressure, a lot of what we call differential stress, when there's pressure from one certain direction. And in that case, that differential stress can also lead to metamorphism. So there's two types of stress, confining pressure and differential stress. And we're going to see that this differential stress is really important in making one particular subtype of metamorphic rocks. So heat and pressure, that's already what we've been talking about for the last several slides. There's another agent, however, that we sometimes call chemically active fluids. Another way of talking about that is just saying hydrothermal fluids, basically hot water. Hot water can also cause alteration and metamorphism. Common places where we get hot water are when there's faults and cracks on the ocean floor where magma is coming up and water is coming down. And we'll talk more about that in the coming weeks. But here's the three common agents that you would learn about in a geology class for metamorphism: heat, two kinds of pressure, and these hydrothermal fluids. Notably, however, heat's present in all cases, because if you're down deep enough that you have this much pressure, it's probably hot. And of course, these chemically active fluids, these hydrothermal fluids, are hot as well. One final point about these three agents of metamorphism: all three of these are likely only to occur pretty deep within the Earth. So likely very deep within the Earth is the only place where you're going to have the extreme temperatures and pressures needed for metamorphism. Thus, if you see a metamorphic rock exposed at the Earth's surface, you know there's probably been a lot of erosion to remove the overlying materials. I want to quickly note one more thing about the rocks that are formed from differential stress, when there's one dominant direction of pressure. These rocks tend to end up being foliated. Foliated metamorphic rocks are metamorphic rocks that have layered crystals. So they're crystalline, kind of like igneous rocks, but in igneous rocks, the crystals are randomly oriented. And in foliated metamorphic rocks, the crystals have a definite layering to them. In fact, when the layers are this distinct, or as I like to say, this nice, we get the rock that's called gneiss. So foliated rocks, or these layered crystals shown in rocks, are a good indicator that you likely have a metamorphic rock. This picture here is taken in Greenland, and we know that metamorphism generally occurs deep in the air, so there must have been a whole lot of erosion that's taken place that's allowed these rocks to now be exposed at the Earth's surface. So how do we identify metamorphic rocks? Well, just like igneous and sedimentary rocks, we're looking at the rock's texture and its mineral composition. Many, but not all, metamorphic rocks contain these layers of crystals that I just referred to. This is called a foliated texture. And again, this is different than the randomly oriented crystals of igneous rocks. And it's also different than the layers of sedimentary rocks, because the layers in sedimentary rocks were of pieces of shells or gravels or sands. And metamorphic rocks, these layers are made of crystals, and it's called foliation. So when we're identifying metamorphic rocks, first we identify if there's foliation or if there's not foliation. And from there, we generally use the mineral composition of the rock to figure out what the name of the rock would be. I find this diagram kind of interesting, so I'll finish up with this as we finish up talking about the different rock types. You can see that most of the rocks in the Earth's crust are either igneous or metamorphic rocks. There's very few sedimentary rocks if we're considering the entirety of the Earth's crust. But if we're only considering the rocks that you and I can see because they're exposed at the surface, you can see that most of the rocks exposed on the Earth's surface are sedimentary rocks. And this makes some sense because sedimentary rocks are the ones that form at or near the Earth's surface. Metamorphic rocks form deep beneath the Earth. Intrusive igneous rocks form deep beneath the Earth. Though it's true that extrusive igneous rocks form near the Earth's surface. Let's check out the United States. You can see that most of the United States, the rock outcrops would be sedimentary rocks. This does not hold true in California, however, which is one reason California is such an interesting place to study geology, because we have a wide variety of all three rock types: sedimentary, metamorphic, and igneous. We'll talk more about the rocks of California in the coming weeks. For a really cool look at the rocks of California, I encourage you to check out this website here. You'll have to pause the video probably to get the website, or you can just Google geologic map of California and you could probably find this website as well. Let's check it out. I've zoomed in a little so we can see it better, but you can see the red stands for granitic rocks, so intrusive igneous rocks. That'd be in the Sierras. And we have some little bits here on the other side of the San Andreas Fault that actually came down. They originally were down here, and they've moved up with the San Andreas Fault. We'll talk more about that later. Then if we look up in Northern California here, we have some extrusive igneous rocks, some volcanic rocks here, up where we have some volcanoes like Mount Lassen and Mount Shasta, etc., up in northeastern California. And then we have some metamorphic rocks in and around. I think this is probably some metamorphic rocks. Yep, some metamorphic sedimentary and metamorphic rocks here. And the purple here is some metamorphic rocks. And we have some of that also in here in the Coast Range as well. Anyway, kind of a cool map to check out all this in here. The yellow is some sedimentary rocks that are brought in and as sediments are deposited from the rivers, etc. I encourage you to check this out. Like, what's this round thing in here in the middle of the Central Valley? Check that out. And what is going on down in Southern California as well? Anyway, have fun. I encourage you to check it out. Lastly, as usual, I encourage you to pause the video and make sure that you can answer the following questions.